Being James Bond, back in action. Yeah, I was looking forward to talking about this again. More contemporary stuff. It is one of your favorite title songs? Not Anya from Spy Who Loved Me? But no, I know exactly what you're saying, yeah. I don't know what the lyrics could have been, but it would have been pretty wacky, I think. Yeah. You know, it's like trying to put a round peg into a square hole. I like this song. I don't like completely love it. It sort of, to me, goes in that Moonraker category, which is nice and it's pleasant, but it's not at the forefront of the Bond title songs. It is interesting, the lyrics of it, too, because it's, you know, an all-time high. It's sort of, you know, Octopussy saying to Bond, look, we've had a lot of romances throughout our lives and so forth, but this is like the all-time high of that. You know, we're perfect for each other in a way, you know? Yeah. That's a very good point. Yeah, because I was thinking about whose point of view could this be? Is it Stacy Sutton? Is it Mayday? I was trying to, you know, and I just realized, no, it's like Live and Let Die. It just doesn't really mean anything, but it sounds great, you know? Yeah, it just sounds cool, yeah. Yeah. It is. I kind of trying to bring myself back to 1985 when I first heard it. I remember, you know, hearing it on the radio maybe a week or a couple weeks before the film was released. And I didn't know quite what to make of it because at the time, I was not into Duran Duran, you know. That to me, you know, I was listening at that point probably like, you know, hard rock. You know, I was like, you know, AC/DC or Queen. I'm like, who are these? What's this boy band? You know, Duran Duran was just like the girls listened to that. And we kind of put up with it. But it was over subsequent listens that I really began to really enjoy the song. It also had a, you know, MTV at that time was probably, I don't know if it was at its peak, but it was very popular. It had really caught on by that time. And they had a video that they had in constant airplay of Duran Duran singing the Voodoo Kill. And the video was really good. It was actually a lot of fun. Thank you. I mean, and you have to remember back then, you know, we set our VCRs so we could record it, just so we could watch like little pieces of the, you know, the film, you know. Yeah. And it was a big hit when it was released. I mean, it reached the number one in the charts in the U.S., number two in the U.K. So, and, you know, Barry enjoyed his collaboration with Duran Duran. So it was like, I guess it was all good or all around. Yeah, it's a good one.
Excuse me, aren't you?
Bond, Simon, Le Bond.
It's interesting because, you know, Barry, again, he worked with, and this would be Barry's swan song in the series, but he worked with A-ha, and he said it was like the complete opposite of working with Duran Duran. He did not like it. But I think, you know, and the idea of doing the Living Daylights, you know, and getting A-ha to do it, you know, they had that hot song, Take On Me, which is a huge hit. And the idea was, let's get another boy band in here and duplicate that success of A View to a Kill. And it didn't quite duplicate the success. I think the song's okay. I like it. I'm always kind of like, in these compilations though, I'm always kind of disappointed because they always give you the long version of the song. It's like 4 minutes and 50 seconds or whatever it is. I'm always, man, I wish there was a radio edit somewhere. You know, I think the song would be better at like 3 minutes. I like it in the film, as used in the film. I really do. It's not as good as A View to Kill, though. Do you really think so? Because I think it's sort of, to me, they were trying to mimic the success. And I think it's kind of similar in that regard. A pretty minor hit in the UK charts. I don't think it really even charted in the US, but I think it peaked at number 5 in the UK. I think they're awesome. Now that one of the things about being a Bond fan, especially back in the day, and you knew John Barry was there, it was like you'd get maybe the LP, you could probably get it maybe a week or a week and a half before the film actually got released. And by this time, I was like, doesn't matter, John Barry, I'm in. I'm buying the album. Yeah, you know, listening to this, and you know, I listened to the Ha Ha song, but then that Where's Everybody Gone came on from the Pretenders. I was like, oh man, this has got that Bond sound. This is awesome, this song. And I remember just being floored by it when I first heard it. They really did. And it just has that, I don't know, it has, I guess there's a, you could say, the throwback to the 60s, you know, with that Bond sound. that wah 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 wah. You know, it just conjures up the old school Bonds, but yet, you know, Barry gives it a little bit of a modern feel with synthesizers and some other things in the score anyway. Yeah, no, that's great. It's almost like his Jaws theme. not the Jaws of the Bond series. Let's not confuse the two. Right. Yeah, no, they do, because, you know, when you see that initial, when he's there and he's jogging and then he strangles that guy, and then later in the film, he's in that, they're in the amusement park there, and then you hear the Walkman, you're like, oh, there he is, he's around somewhere, you know, and he's selling balloons, I think, you know, which also could be a tribute to the Third Man, but maybe I'm stretching, but... That's an interesting idea for a compilation, actually, like Soft Listening Bond. Yeah. I mean, again, you know, it's Barry collaborating with the Pretenders, and, you know, another one out of the park. I mean, it should be noted, this is Barry's last Bond score, sadly, and he does appear at the end of the film conducting an orchestra, so which is very appropriate, I think. He's there with Kara and her cello. So, yeah, I mean, it's as great as The Living Daylights is and the soundtrack is, it's also kind of a sad thing. You know, it's the end of an era. I mean, I didn't know it at the time. I always held out, well, you know, this is one of my first questions, you know, is Barry going to do it? Is Barry going to do it? You know? He did. Oh, it's great. Right. I guess one could argue, you know, it helps that Barry helping you orchestrate. Yeah, I think we might have discussed it in another podcast or... Yeah, you know, I always felt... I don't think the song is bad. I actually kind of like the song. But I think it's wrong for the whole tone of the film. This is one of the first times where I felt they got the title song kind of wrong for the tone. And it's actually, when you look back on it, you're like, that's actually a pretty rare occurrence. Escape me. If I get my sights on you, I I mean, I think it would have been okay if you were going to do like one of the like a typical Moore entry. It probably would have fit, you know, because his stuff, all his films were, although they had serious moments like in, like For Your Eyes Only, and certainly like the second half of Octopussy. This was more of a harder edge Bond, so it needed to be approached differently, you know, because they were doing something different. That's very true. Used to be that I believe in something. Used to be that I believe in love. It's been a long time since I've had that feeling. Oh, you mean if you asked me to? Yes, Celine Dion had a big, huge hit with that afterwards. Because, you know, that came out, so I was like, oh, this is a really nice song. And I thought, now we're talking, it was an appropriate way for the title. The way the film ends, it was kind of an appropriate song. Yeah, I thought it was a really good song, but just never really did anything at the time of the release, the Patti LaBelle version from the film. And then, yeah, a few years later, Celine Dion, and it was a smash. I know. Yeah, no, you know, these, like I said, in the Moore era, they would have been fine, you know, if they had gotten them for, you know, I don't know, Octopussy, let's say. You know, I mean, Glass Knight probably would have done a fine job with All Time High as well, you know? It's better than All Time High, man. No. No, I'm kidding. It is. It's sort of like Bond meets Die Hard, kind of, sort of Lethal Weapon a little bit. So we could listen to Dirty Love. There you go. I'm here to help. that obviously this is the scuzzy bar that, you know, and it's appropriate for the scene again, but, you know, it's like not really, never ever makes my compilation CDs, you know? We should make a compilation disc where it's Bond B-sides, and it has, like, you know, Make It Last All Night, Dirty Love. That'd be fun. But listening to them all together might be kind of a fun experience, or maybe an excruciating one, depending on your point of view. I don't know. Product of its time. I don't think it's any better or worse than Make It Last All Night. It's maybe a little more innocent than that. But overall, I think it kind of fits the scene. And supposedly there's still a bar. I don't know if it's still around, but that hole that's blown in the side of the wall is still there. Oh, they did? No kidding. Is that right? You know, composed by U2, Bono. I think it's a fantastic song. I think Tina Turner is a good, I guess you could say, substitute for Shirley Bassey. She's like from that kind of sort of same vocal school. And I just think it's a terrific song. What do you think lyric-wise? Who do you think this, which character does this represent? I always felt that was sort of like Tina Turner talking about James Bond. Like, I watched you from the shadows as a child, but now I'm getting to sing a song for you. You know? Yeah. Yeah. Right. Yeah, no, I agreed. Oh, absolutely. I just one of those, it's one of those ones when I hear, like, there's certain ones, like, if I'm listening to, like, a compilation CD or whatever, of title songs, that's one I always kind of, like, always, you know, my hand's on the volume, I'll turn it up a little bit. Very much so. You know what's interesting about this guy, Eric Serra? I know that, you know, he's got a lot of brick brats about the GoldenEye music, orchestral music that he made for the film. But he had such success with Lou Besson, the director, you know, La Femme Nikita, The Fifth Element, and Leon. It's kind of, and I kind of see, like, in Leon, his score works so well, and it's kind of interesting how the GoldenEye score doesn't really work so much. That's horrible. The beginning. That is pretty bad. That's interesting because they had a pretty cool James Bond theme that they used. It was done by a group called Parody Fair, and it was used for the GoldenEye trailer, which I think is a marvelous piece of music. It actually appears, there was a James Bond compilation that went up until, let's see, oh yeah, okay, it was around the time, it was released around the time of The World Is Not Enough. Thank you. To be honest, that after maybe a few beers, I don't think I'd remember either. I like this. You know, I was back in the day, I was kind of excited about this because I was a Sheryl Crow fan. I had like had a couple of her albums. Tomorrow Never Dies. I think it's a solid song. And not to jump ahead here, but I guess I'm gonna. I much prefer Surrender by Katie Lang. Now that is a kick-ass song. Consensus? I do too. Don't get me wrong. I don't dislike it at all. It's funny too, like with Katie Lang, it's like I never thought, like, you know, when you think of who could compose a really good Bond or sing a very good Bond song, she'd be like the last on my list. But here she is, kicking ass on the Surrender song. Well, I always felt like that song was like sort of the apology song for the film. I know. I am not. I can't. Well, that's like. Oh, well, that's another discussion.
Bond. James Bond.
Which is a nice little kind of fluff piece, I guess. Almost a promotional thing, but it's kind of cool. Is that right? I didn't know that. And it's weird, they sample dialogue from Goldfinger in this one. Is that the right? Because I know there's a couple. There are two that are almost indistinguishable to me. Oh, okay, it's the Paul Oakenfold one, too, I think. Oakenfold? Those, between that and the movie one, boy, they're pretty interchangeable as far as I'm concerned. But anyway. Yeah. It does. With this one's a bunch of garbage. By garbage, yes. No. I was playing words that garbage. No, I actually like this song a lot. I think it's a pretty cool, you know, as we know, World Is Not Enough is the coat of arms, the bond. We learned that in the Majesty's Secret Service. And I guess it's from the point of view of Elektra, I guess the lyrics you could argue, you know. Because, you know, for her, the world is not enough. She needs more and more. She's just a greedy, girl. Garbage, a.k.a. Shirley Manson, I think it is, right? Yeah, I think this, you know, and I believe this was co-composed with Arnold, I want to say. I hope I'm not wrong on that. But, yeah, I think it's a solid song. The only thing I'd say about it, we're getting deeper into the catalog, is some of these songs kind of lose their identity a little bit. One is sort of little more interchangeable to the other. You know what I'm saying? They all kind of want to evoke that Bond sound and that kind of ballady, and we're getting a little repetitious now. Even though the quality of The World Is Not Enough, the song is fine. I mean, I like the lyrics to this song and everything else. Yeah, it kind of has enough of that Bond sound to be legit and part of the catalog, but I don't see it shooting anybody's, you know, favorite list, you know? Yeah, I like it. I mean, it's sort of got a backlash. I would say more people are pro Tomorrow Never Dies than they are World Is Not Enough. I personally think World Is Not Enough to me was more like an apology film. It was wasn't as good as GoldenEye, but it was much better. I mean, that opening sequence is better than anything you see in Tomorrow Never Dies, as far as I'm concerned, but that's only me. I know that you have a little more of a... Yeah, okay. Well, if you don't like it, you only have yourself to blame. No, only myself to blame. This is complete garbage. I can't stand the song. I didn't even have a critical analysis, just that I hate it. I can't stand the way that guy, Scott Walker, the way he moans onto that track. He sounds like a moose that needs to be put out of its misery. It's a horrible song. I think when I first picked up the soundtrack, I listened to it, I was like, really? Holy man, I never ever mellowed out on it. You know, usually you get some nostalgia to these things and you're like, well, I can forgive this. And, you know, I'd rather listen to Dirty Love 20 times over than listen to Only. Yeah, I do not like Only Myself to Blame. It sounds like some dude 3 o'clock in the morning doing karaoke. I guess I'm being a little rough on it. I don't think the lyrics are that bad, but I just dislike the song so much that I just completely disconnected on it. I guess I'm not a good critical judge of this song. He does. I mean, Arnold did compose it. I don't think the melody is all bad. I guess my biggest issue with it is the Scott Walker vocal. Yeah, I have to admit, back in the day, I liked Madonna. There's a lot of songs I did like that she did, I must admit. There were the fun, guilty pleasures. This song, though, didn't like it. I've been kind of a weird relationship with this song. It's because I didn't like it at first, then I kind of liked it, and now I'm kind of like on a downward spiral with it, where I'm kind of not liking it too much again. Yeah. I would say most fans that I've like caught on boards and stuff, most of them cite this one as their least favorite title song. Yes. you're being hypnotized by it. There's so. I picked up used at one point. It's like a Madonna, and it's got like a bunch of different versions of the song on it. Because what I really wanted was the. There's like sort of an end title version of it that I kind of have. It's kind of not exactly what they use in the end titles, but it's longer. It's considerably longer, like 8 minutes or something. It's pretty damn long, but it's kind of neat, because it's not as electronic-y as the song here. It's more of a melody, and it's a little more pleasing, I think. I think it's pretty interchangeable, and to be honest with you, I like the Moby one better. That's my personal opinion. So I mean, it's neat to have it. I kind of dig it, but ultimately, yeah, it's kind of more of the same. Yeah, like I like the GoldenEye trailer music better, to be honest with you. When we're getting to that type of instrumental synthesizer. Okay. Right, so he's getting, so he's making some little cash on that on the side. Yeah. Yeah, agreed. I can't say I was in love with it when I first heard it, but then when I saw it married to the main title sequence, I absolutely adored it. I thought it was fantastic. And I was like, oh, this is, yeah, this is great. You know? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yes. Oh, it's fantastic. It's a fantastic sequence. Yeah. It's the best thing since, you know, Maurice Binder, you know? And even trumps some of his, because we were talking about later on how his titles got a little tired. You know? Fun. Don't get me wrong. They're always fun and great, but yeah. Yeah, no, that was, yeah, that was my lightning rod moment where I just said, "Wow, yes, it all came together, and yes, this is fantastic, and you know, I'm floored, you know." And you know what's cool about this? I like the way that Arnold used some of this song in the underscore of the film. You hear little notes of it, and it's really cool to hear that. I mean, I like when they use the title songs as sort of the backbone of the score. I think it gives the score its identity. And I think Arnold did a great job. Yeah. Right, and Arnold was under orders this time. He says they were like, no James Bond theme till the very end. It does. Oh, it's great. I love what he did because, like, after, you know, we were talking about Eric Serra, after that kind of debacle, he was a welcome presence. You know, I might surprise you in this one. I really like this one. Yeah, no. I know it gets a lot of hate. I know a lot of people don't like it. I like it. I think it's a first for the Bonds. It's like the first duet title song, which is kind of cool. I just think it kind of has like a little bit of a Bond sound. One could say, I don't think it's a great song, but it's a good one. I think it sort of like kind of captures the film and I think it does its job. It's not extraordinary, but it's pretty good. Really? No kidding. I
I'm no tricky nigga, gone here, but I'm a stupid one, and I'll never see the sunshine. Another inch of your life sacrifice for your brother. I'm on the dirty money, heaven set, money turning on a dime.
Well, I'm not going to try to hum it, so. No, I think it's fine. You know, it's to me, it's neither fish or fowl, if that's a good way to put it. It doesn't offend me, but yet I don't think it's great either. So it's like one of those middle-of-the-road ones for me. I think it's okay. I put it like into sort of like the world is not enough category, that kind of thing. It's just okay, you know? Well, if you want to have that opinion. A lot of people agree with you. I think I'm in the minority here. So maybe I'm going to play devil's advocate. But it's my true feelings. No, that is a legitimate point, you know? Yeah. Right. Wow, okay. I'm gonna mark you down as undecided. Right. So is this like your personal apology to Michael Wilson and Barbara Broccoli? Please don't be too hard on me. Send me more memorabilia. Yes. Yeah, because surprisingly, I guess given the length of Quantum, it's one of the shorter Bond films. The entire soundtrack is available, you know, as a complete thing when it first got released, which usually never happens. There's usually always a couple things missing, but Quantum is pretty complete right out of the gate. The only thing it's missing is this end title crawl, which I got later off of like iTunes or something like that. Which I don't really like doing. I hate digital downloads for music, but, you know, I had to do what I had to do. But I really like this. I think it's cool. I think it almost seems like a last-minute replacement. Like, they didn't like what Arnold did or something, so they decided to go with this. Yeah, I mean, I created my own Quantum album and, you know, threw this on at the end and it was like perfect. It was like one of the easiest things I ever did is I just threw this on. I just let the thing play and just threw this on the end. Ooh, complete soundtrack. It was like one of the easiest things ever, you know? Yeah. No, it doesn't. No. Absolutely agree. Very cool stuff. Yeah, we're kind of near the final stretch here. Yeah, I think it's a pretty great song. I mean, I loved this when I first heard it, and it just, you know, it worked. I think they did a really cool main title sequence with the song, and it still works, and I think it's a great song overall.
This is the end. Hold your breath and count to ten. Feel the earth move and then hear my heart burst again, for this is the end. I've drowned and dreamt this moment, so overdue I owe them. Swept away I'm stolen.
It is weird about it, because it does recall songs of old, but yet it's its own thing. Somehow, I don't know how they did that. It's a neat trick. Yeah, it is. Oh, I agree wholeheartedly. She got an Oscar nomination. I don't think it won. Well, maybe she did win the Oscar. That's absolutely right. Very common knowledge. No. This was she does. I mean, it's so perfect. I mean, it's sort of a capper onto a really good movie. Overall, this is a really good movie, and that was like sort of the icing on the cake, the cherry on top, whatever, what have you. It just like was like, yeah, we got a great title song. I didn't like the song at all when I first heard it. I just didn't think it was, I don't know, it just didn't seem like a Bondian song, you know? It just kind of... I didn't like it. I heard, you know, the opening bars, like the first 15, 20 seconds, I'm like, oh, cool. And then the guy starts singing, Sam Smith. And I was just like, oh, it's like that, huh? And it... They are. I know. What happened? What are they thinking? And I know there was online, there were people saying, oh, it's not too late. They can change the song. And it was like, there was almost like this last minute campaign to get the song taken away. Or they were like, just throw it on the end credits or something. Surprisingly, I mean, I felt that the song kind of worked in the title sequence. I didn't hate it. It, you know, I guess maybe with the, you know, the stereo going, you know, the surround sound, the Dolby surround going and stuff like that, and they're blasting it. The movie sounded really good, and you have all those kind of crazy visuals. In its own weird way, it kind of worked for me. I'm not totally like sold on it, but it wasn't as horrible. As you know, because when I first heard it, it was almost like, you know, I had a reaction like, you know, when you have a cold and you take some cough syrup and you're like, ooh, you know, that was my first reaction, you know. There were certain things in the title sequence that threw me, because there were some visuals there that I was like, oh, I don't like that. And that might have also affected the overall performance of the song. No, I hear you. You know, I didn't know the variations because I only heard the song. I have to admit, I didn't give it much of a chance. I only heard the song really like once, all the way through, and I was just like, oh, you know what? Let me just, we'll leave that alone, and you know, I'll see it when the movie comes out. And I get, yeah, a final analysis. So not up there with my favorite songs, but I don't think it's as bad as my initial knee-jerk reaction. It's okay in the film, and you know, I want a better song, but you know, it is what it is, and it's done, it's over with. So the soundtrack album that they've released, that which I don't have yet but I'm going to pick up, doesn't have the song. It has an instrumental, but it doesn't, which actually might be a pretty good thing. But you know, for me, the stupid Bond completist notion I have, especially with the music, I probably will drop a few bucks on the CD single. So no, I mean, I think we're pretty good. I mean, there are fans of certain, like say, like just like Star Trek fans, Star Wars fans, and so forth, and they love everything. And I think we do a pretty good balance of giving our true opinions and not whitewashing everything and saying, hey, no, we didn't like this. Hey, this is pretty good over here. So, and I think that's good. I think just being honest about it is, you know, all we can really do. You know? That's what makes Bond fans cool. We're honest.